Welcome, and thank you for watching the third episode of our Top Trends in Education video series. These videos are a series of discussions with industry experts that aim to shed light on current trends shaping the future of education. I am Rob Curtin, Director of Worldwide Higher Education at Microsoft, and today we're going to focus on the skills gap, technology, and the role and evolving role of lifelong learning. I'm joined by Jane Oates, President of WorkingNation. WorkingNation is a nonprofit organization that brings attention to the labor crisis in the U.S. and highlights realistic solutions. Medium and Journalism Group is trying to highlight the systemic causes of unemployment, how workforce development can be better implemented. In addition to her full-time job, Jane also serves on various boards, including the boards for the National Council for Community and Education Partnerships and the Center for Workforce Inclusion. So Jane, thank you for joining us today. And to get us started, you are clearly steeped in the unemployment and workforce development topics. You know an awful lot about the skills gap, but for me and others that may have a variety of definitions, how would you define it?
So first of all, thanks, Rob, so much. I'm looking forward to our conversation. And very simply, the skills gap is what's missing between what you know or what you learned and what employers say you need in order to qualify for a job. So that can be anything from a technical skill. It can be something that you should have learned, basic skill, reading, mathematics, or it could be, you know, what I would call an emerging skill in that space in technology.
Why does it exist? Is the skills gap something that we've always had? Is it new?
So I think there's always been opportunities for people to learn different skills so they could qualify for different jobs. But the reality is that technology has really exacerbated the skills that we need for every job. There's almost no job that I can think of that you don't need technological skills. So why is it worse now? I mean, I think that the speed at which technology is changing the workplace is so rapid that it's really hard for education to keep up. Think about how long it takes to get a new course approved, you know, at a 2 or 4 year college. I mean, maybe 12 months, but most of the time it's 18 months. And that's not because they're slow or lazy. It's because they want to ensure quality. But basically that timeline means once you've adapted for a new technological skill, it's likely to be obsolete by the time you've implemented in your educational program. So it really is a challenge.
We've sort of done a nice job of highlighting that tech is often the driver of the skills gap. And notably, as you point out, the demands from industry outpace the quality control infrastructure of valued and trusted education. So I think one of the first questions would be, is technology potentially also part of the solution? And then the second part of that is, you know, toward what do we want to direct that solution? And I heard you mention lifelong learning. So in particular, can we talk about technology and how it might help us with lifelong learning?
I think technology has to be a part of the solution. There's no question. Technology offers the opportunity to have bite-sized chunks of information consumed by individuals, whether they're job seekers or whether they're incumbent workers. Technology needs to become a part of traditional education, and it needs to be an important part, to me, a critical part of ongoing lifelong learning so that I can identify for myself, gosh, I need to learn this so that I can do my current job better or I can qualify for a different job.
One of the things that I see is, yes, technology can provide more options. It can be more inclusive as far as bringing people in. And there's also a great deal of data that comes out of it. Mm-hmm. But getting people to embrace these practices, getting universities to break with some systems and faculty to break with some practices. So I know you've had a lot of work in working with institutions on the challenges to adoption, not just the acquisition of technology or the consideration. What do you see are some of the challenges around embracing it as a new practice and driving adoption across traditional faculty?
So, you know, I'm recovering faculty long time ago, but the reality is change is hard. I mean, when you're asking people, I loved when you brought up that people, you know, want a sense of belonging. They want to feel like they're not an imposter, that they really belong in this educational situation. But faculty is very comfortable because, as I said when we were talking before, you know, many people were successful in this old traditional model. The problem is it wasn't success for all. And many people left education. In fact, 39 million people in this country, 39 million, have some college and no degree. Now, that could also mean they have some debt. But they left college for a reason. Life got in the way, or they didn't feel that sense of belonging. They felt like education wasn't for them. First question is, how do we bring those people back and get them their degrees? Second question is, how do we make them feel successful? How do we give them the confidence to really believe that A, they can learn, and B, they can learn efficiently? It's not going to take them years to get what they need. Now, that's where you have to change the mindset of some colleges. First, bringing them back, accepting their previously earned credits, allowing them to take some tests to show that they have knowledge in areas where they didn't take a college course, and showing them a pathway that's relevant and as I said before, efficient.
So you've really hit, I think, you know, at some level, where core, at least I am, a very practical economist, right? And so any market needs buyers and sellers. Some people call them pitchers and catchers, et cetera. But 39 million students in the United States represents a massive business opportunity. Excellent. So from the provider side, there's a shrinking demographic in the U.S. of traditional age learners and even households that are questioning the value of the debt that you pointed out. But there's 39 million students, right? Fundamentally, a doubling of the market more, right? To say there's a reason to provide new alternatives and new pathways. And I think from an institutional standpoint, how do we take the credits you've earned, right, and start to convert them into a credential or something you can be very proud of, right? How do we see credentialing evolving? Obviously, we've had BA, BS, but from an employability standpoint, can we become more granular? What might credentialing look like so that we light up those 39 million students and clarify the offer?
You know, I think one of the most impressive things I've seen colleges do is embed credentials. So high quality credentials that are industry recognized, that are assessed, and that are shorter term, so have to be reassessed, not that one and done that we were talking about before. Those kinds of credentials are critically important. They give somebody on their way to a degree an economic boost. So they get an increase in their hourly pay, or they get a different salary job because they have credentials. Think of the kinds of credentials that I think of when I think of having real boost. Finally, Rob, I would say this embedding does not dilute the academic education at all. It just is sequencing courses in a way that students can see an earlier benefit than waiting for the final benefit of the degree. Professors who say, you know, looking at workforce dilutes the academics are to me in the dinosaur era. You know, they have to understand that vocational education is getting all of us ready for the jobs of today and tomorrow.
As we leave, is there anything that we haven't touched on, or are there some final thoughts of encouragement or opportunity that you have for institutions today?
I would say to you that colleges have to start thinking about what they need to do to attract learners from 22 to 82, because we're staying in the workplace longer. We shouldn't make assumptions about any age group. You know, there are some 17 and 18 year olds who I don't think are very good with doing business level technology. And there are some 70 year olds who are doing a great job of it. So really, I think your advice, listen to the learner, don't make assumptions about them, give them what they want at a high quality, and you're going to help both your institution, the individual, of course, but you're going to help the economy. It's going to be so great if everybody feels the confidence that there's a post-secondary seat for them online or in seat.
Jane, thank you. your insight on this, your expertise. It's just, it's motivating for me, and I hope others find it just as inspirational. So if you're interested in hearing more other perspectives on our top trends in education, please watch the rest of our series, where we have other industry experts discussing the latest trends they're seeing at the intersection of technology and education. So stay tuned, and we'll see you again soon.